God bless you, loved ones. Welcome to the Word with Chester. Today we'll begin study in the 7th chapter of the book of 1 Corinthians. Before we start our study, let me ask you, I would love to have your input about this ministry, what you think about what we're doing, and do you think that this ministry is worth me investing into editing our programs to put out a more perfect program? I must be honest with you, what you've heard this far for the last year and a half is just me as I am. We haven't edited anything. I haven't did anything to make our broadcast any better or try to make it elaborate or anything of that nature. I want to know your input. Do you think it would improve this ministry for me to invest in editing and all of that type of thing? I will be honest, it would be a short time financial hardship. I'll be honest with you, no one has donated to this ministry as of yet. Everything that you have seen done, every broadcast, what all of the cost thereof has come from me. But I want you to know, if you are enjoying this ministry enough for me to invest into all that it takes to make it a more perfect program, do you think that would be beneficial to this ministry or not? You can contact me at my website. That website is www.poemsbychester.com. Click on where it says about the author, and there is a place there for you to make comments. Also, leave me your name, if you would, and how I can return your email. That way, I will know how to lead this ministry and which direction that we could take it. I will tell you that I am subject to this economy like everyone else, and I only have so much money that I can spend. But if it will be beneficial, if you would enjoy this program more, or you think that we would attract more people by editing and try to make a more perfect program, I will invest and try to do that. But I want to know if you are receiving the Word of God as I am putting it out there as now. As I said, what you see is what you get. I haven't edited anything. It's just been me, myself, teaching the Word of God. Well, shall we go to our study today? We'll begin our study at verse 1, chapter 7, the book of 1 Corinthians. The Bible reads, "Now concerning the things about which ye wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman." Now, you have to understand what the Apostle Paul was dealing with here. And I know that's a hard saying, especially in the day that we live. But Apostle Paul was dealing with a case, and he had received news that so much fornication was going on in the church at Corinth. And also he had dealt with a case of incest in this same church. So Apostle Paul was dealing with a real situation, and now he's addressing what he heard in the letter. Those of you, this is your first time, go to our archives, listen to our last lesson. Apostle Paul talked to us about fornication through chapter 6 and told us to flee fornication. Also talked to us about many things, laying down with the ladies of the night and all those type of things the Apostle Paul talked to us about. And here, as you have to understand the flow of this letter. This is a letter to the Corinthian church, just like I instructed you and talked to you as we studied the book of Romans. Same thing happening here. Apostle Paul is writing the letter, so you have to get the flow. The chapter has changed, but the subject matter has not changed. I've told you many times that the Bible was divided into chapters and verses for your and my benefit. It wasn't there from the beginning. This is one continuous letter, but in chapter 7, you have to understand, we're flowing, same subject matter. We just got through talking about fornication, and Apostle Paul let us know that our bodies were the temple of the Holy Ghost, and we ought to carry ourselves as such, that this body is a temple of the Holy Ghost. And as we continue that flow in this letter, Now concerning the things about which ye wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. What do you mean it's good for a man not to touch a woman? We're going to get understanding as we read. Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. Well, Apostle Paul knows that we're human beings. All of us have a sex drive, if you please, and all of us desire to be touched in that manner. I'm not going to go into a perfect detail on every way, but there's a drive that I believe God put down in us. But the Apostle Paul is letting us know it's good for a man not to touch a woman, but to avoid fornication. Let me let you know why. And we're gonna discuss why it's good for a man not to touch a woman. But get the picture. To avoid fornication, every man should have his own wife, and every woman have her own husband. So Apostle Paul is making that plain. Shall we read on? Let the husband render unto the wife her due, and likewise also the wife unto her husband. What are you talking about? Let the husband render to the wife her due, and vice versa. What are you talking about? We're talking about avoiding fornication, avoiding sexual sins and things of that nature. Well, Apostle Paul said, if you married, the husband is supposed to render to the wife her due. In other words, don't be putting folks on restriction. What are you talking about on restriction? Holding back sex so they, because you mad at them, holding back intimacy because you can, or to get what you want, or to manipulate a man. All of those things are not of God. Let the husband render unto the wife her do. In other words, when she is aroused, you're supposed to take care of business. Do I need to make it any plainer than that? And likewise also the wife unto the husband. You're supposed to take care of business when he is aroused. Well, shall we continue reading? The wife hath not power over her own body. The wife does not have power over her own body, but the husband. And likewise also the husband hath not power over his body, but the wife. In other words, you belong to each other. And you are there, and she has the power over your body. When she wants you and desires you, you're supposed to give her what she needs. I'm trying to be discreet about this and not venture off into a rated X session here, but I want you to know Apostle Paul is dealing with a situation here. Well, you might wonder why come it is so much adultery here and adultery there and adultery there. Well, you can't blame it all because the wife is not giving the man what he needs and vice versa. Sometimes that is the case. And Apostle Paul is dealing with a church here. I'm going to let you know the truth. I've been in the church for a lot of years. And I've served the Lord for a lot of years. And so many times you can get so wrapped up in the ministry, you forget that there's a need there. And a husband needs his wife. And a wife needs her husband. You can't be so wrapped up in ministry, wrapped up in your personal whatever life you do, and not take care of that side of life. It is important. And all these things help avoid sexual sins and sexual temptations. I will let you know, though, temptation is going to always be there. There's going to be always somebody to tempt you. Y'all need to pray for me. I'm a man. If I see a good-looking woman, I notice. Ain't no sense in me trying to lie to you and no one else. I notice if she fine. I notice if she look good. And you can't throw a rock and hit me because I notice if somebody look good. But that's not I'm not supposed to be over there trying to, you know what I'm trying to talk to you about today. Well, you have to understand that there's always going to be temptation. But to avoid people yielding to temptation, if everybody did what they're supposed to do, all the business is being taken care of at home. The husband giving his wife, giving the wife what she needs, and the wife giving the husband what she needs. I am talking about sexuality now. I'm talking about sexual intimacy now. You have to do that, otherwise that drive in a man, if he's not being and satisfied, will venture, and I, Enos and Meline, there's a whole lot of folks that will venture anyway, but you need all the help you can get so that you won't venture. There are sincere people that are really trying to please the Lord. If you do the right thing and a person is really trying to please the Lord, he's going to do the right thing by you. I hope you understand what I am saying. Verse 5. It reads, defraud ye not one another, defraud ye not one another, except it be with consent for a time, that ye may give yourself to fasting and prayer, and come together again, that Satan tempt you not for your inconsistency. Apostle Paul is talking about sex. You want a sex education lesson? This is a good one here. You need to read it and understand. He said, defraud ye not one another. The next time your wife is not giving you what you do, you have to tell her she's a fraud. Well, Apostle Paul said it, defraud ye not one another. She's defrauding you, or you're defrauding her, if you're not giving her what she needs in a sexual manner. Well, I hope you hear what I'm saying. Shall I continue reading? But I speak this by permission and not by command. Now let me back up in verse 5. He said it be with consent. Now there is time that when a person wants to go on a fast and want to seek God and entreat God for things, and they want to give that time to the Lord, and they are not given to give you the sexual wants that you need during that time, it ought to be with consent. This is what Apostle Paul is saying. You ought to let your wife know, you ought to let your husband know that I'm getting ready to go on a fast, I'm getting ready to consecrate a few days. If it seems that I am withdrawn, this is what it's all about. It's not that I'm mad at you, it's not that I'm angry or have attitude, but I'm giving myself to God for these few days. So the Apostle Paul says with consent. When you communicate that way, the husband or the wife knows what the other is doing. And that way he won't get mad at you when you don't give him what he's asking for. Or she won't get mad at you for not giving her what she's asking for. I hope you hear me today. Shall we read in verse 6? But I speak this by permission and not by commandment. For I would that all men were even as I myself. But every man hath his proper gift of God, and after this manner, another after that. What is Apostle Paul saying? Now see, you have to understand, Apostle Paul was not married. Apostle Paul gave himself to ministry. He was traveling all over and preaching the word of God here and there. His lifestyle would have been to where if he would have had a wife, it would have been a strain on her because she would have had to travel with him or either go long spaces of time without seeing him or coming together with them. So Apostle Paul said, I would that all men were even as I myself, but every man has his proper gift. Everybody is not called to that ministry. Everybody is not called to be single. Let me let you know there's some folks that need a mate. Some folks need a wife, otherwise they will be cutting up. But every man had his proper gift of God, one after this manner, another after that. Verse 8 reads, I say therefore to the unmarried and widows, it is good for them if they abide even as I. The unmarried and the widows, if you stay single, you can give yourself to God and do a greater work for God, or at least put more time into giving yourself to God. Well, that's the word of God. I can't make it any plainer than that. Shall we continue reading in verse 9? But if they cannot, the old King James Version said, if they cannot contain, the newer version said, but if they cannot have self-control, let them marry. For it is better to marry marry than to burn. Now, if you don't have self-control and you got a problem in that area, it's better for you to marry. What are you talking about? It's better for you to marry than to, go through all the choir and then skip from the choir to the deaconess board and then you're on your way to the mother's board. You got a problem. You need to deal with that thing. You need to get married to one person and stay with that one person. If you're prone to sexual mistakes and prone to having to have that type of relationship, you need to get married and be married. Now, ain't nothing wrong with being married. Apostle Paul is saying, I'm not giving you a commandment on this. It's better if you stay single. That way you can give yourself to the work of God. But if you have that sex drive and you need someone, you just need someone. And you ought to do what it takes to live a clean life. If you need someone, just be honest with yourself. Don't take the weak person's way out all the time. But let me let you also know, if you know yourself, you just know yourself. And so it's better for you to get someone and have that one person and get married to them. I know you are. Many of you don't know me. You don't know me from anybody else. But I'm teaching you the word of God. There's been many mistakes made in the church realm and with people because this subject was really not dealt with. Sexuality is a part of our life, and you have to deal with it. Either you want to please God or you don't want to please God. If you really want to please Him, you need to know yourself and know what you need to do to live a clean life. If you have to have you somebody, then you really need to get you somebody and stay with that one. I hope you're hearing me. But if they cannot contain or have self-control, let them marry, for it is better to marry than to burn. Number one, burn inside and burn in lust, and then ultimately burn in hell. So you need to do whatever it takes to fix that problem so that you can live a clean and overcoming life for Jesus. Shall we continue in verse 10? And to the married, I command ye not. Now get that word, I command. In that first statement, he said, this is not a commandment. I wish that you were all like me, but if you can't contain, you should marry. All of these things we talked about, that wasn't a commandment. But now in verse 10, and unto the married, I command. Yet not I, but the Lord. Let not the wife depart from her husband. She depart, let her remain unmarried. That's a hard saying. Let not the wife depart from her husband. If she do leave him, the Apostle Paul is saying, let her remain unmarried. But if she depart, let her remain unmarried or be reconciled to her husband. We're talking about believers now. And let not the husband put away his wife. We're all looking for loopholes, trying to get out of it. I don't understand it. But it's the way it is. Folks that are single, oh, hurry up, I need somebody, let me get married. And then on the other hand, those ones that are married trying to find a loophole to get out. The word of God, Apostle Paul, is letting us know you're supposed to stay together. I don't care who got divorced. I don't care if I am a bad example in what I'm talking about now. The word of God is always right. Always read the word of God. It's not what you see this one do or not what you see that one do. Your focus should be on the word of God. Now, I will say this. If you're caught up in a situation you end up single, that applies to you. If you can contain yourself instead of jumping from here and jumping from that, going through all the ladies you see and all of that, ain't no sense in lying. All men have a sex drive, and most women have a sex drive. I better be cool on that one. But you got to understand, you have to do whatever it takes for you to live right. Shall I read on? Let not the husband put away his wife, verse 12, but to the rest speak I, not the Lord. I love that about Apostle Paul. He'll let you know when this is a commandment, or this is coming from the Lord, or when it's just me talking. I can say a lot of words, but let me let you know, I should always let you know that this is the word of the Lord. This is God talking here and not me. And that's one reason I love the Apostle Paul's teaching. But to the rest speak I, not the Lord. If any man hath a wife that believeth not, she's not saved, she's not a believer, and she be pleased to dwell with thee, let him not put her away. Well, if you're married to an unbeliever and you love your wife, you're supposed to stay with your wife. And don't let nobody try to tell you, well, she ain't saved, you don't even need her. All that kind of stuff is nonsense. Number one, you shouldn't have everybody in your marriage anyway. Everybody should be on the outside. It should be you and your spouse dealing with your situation. I've got to read that again. But to the rest, speak I, not the Lord. If any brother hath a wife that believeth not, and she be pleased to dwell with him, let him not put her away. Verse 13, and the woman who hath a husband that believeth not, and if he be pleased to dwell with her, let her not leave him. In other words, Apostle Paul is saying, if you love the man, stay with the man. If you love the woman, stay with the woman, even if she is not a believer. Well, you got to understand these things. Shall we read verse 14? For the unbelieving husband, is sanctified by the wife. Get that. And the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. Else were your children unclean, but now they are holy, because you're holy, because you have the ways of God and the Spirit of God in you. Your children can also have what you have, even if your husband or vice versa, your spouse, is not saved, because you, that husband is sanctified by the wife, and that wife is sanctified by the husband, and sanctified really just simply means cleaned up. I guess I should talk on that a little bit further, but it is an important verse about folks staying together. All the Apostle Paul is doing, and Jesus even told us, that we're supposed to be trying to stay together and not be pulled apart. Shall we read verse 15? But if the unbelieving depart, let him depart. A brother or a sister is not under bondage in such case. If they leave you because you're saved. I ain't talking about leave you because you cutting up and raising all kind of hell at home and all that kind of. I'm talking about if they leave you because you're saved, or they leave you because you're a believer. If they leave you, a brother or sister is not under bondage in such a case. You're not under that bondage. If by chance you find yourself burning or being in want of sexual intimacy, you should marry or remarry in that case, but God hath called us to peace. Let me read that again. But if the unbelieving depart, let him depart. A brother or sister is not under bondage in such case, but God hath called us to peace. God wants you and I to have peace and not turmoil, even in the home. He wants you and I to have peace. For what knowest thou, O wife, whether thou shalt save thy husband? Or how knowest thou, O man, whether thou shalt save thy wife? If you live a life before your husband and he's not saved, you could be the cause of him wanting to be saved. I can tell you that by my own dad, my own father. He wasn't saved for a lot of years, but I talked to him. My dad said, your mother is one I lived with her for over 30 years, and I can't even spot a life. That's what my dad said about my mother, and I want you to know, dad did not get saved in the early years of those marriage. In fact, my dad got saved. My mother is deceased and was deceased. After my mother became deceased, after a time, my father got saved. He got saved before he passed away. So God can use you even for the salvation of your husband or your wife. Now that's the word of the Lord. Shall we Let me read just a few more verses. But as God has distributed to every man, as the Lord has called everyone, so let him walk. If God called you to be single, be single. Walk that way and walk with integrity. If God called you to be married, be married. Walk that way and live like a good married person should live. Be true to your husband. Be true to your wife and love your wife and love your husband. That's what Apostle Paul is saying here. However God has called you to be, God, but God has not had distributed to every man as the Lord has called everyone. So let him walk. You walk that way. And so ordain I in all churches. All the churches, not just one. We're supposed to be all doing the same thing. Come on now. Shall we read quickly verse 18? As any man called, is any man called being circumcised? Here we are with that problem again between circumcision, between Jews and also the Gentiles. Is any man called being circumcised? Did God call you because you're circumcised? Let him not become uncircumcised. Is any man called uncircumcised? Let him not be circumcised. In other words, quit worrying about all these trivial matters. If God called you that way and saved you that way, you ain't got to change because somebody else wants you to change in that area. I'm talking about circumcision now, and I'm not going to tell you exactly what that means at this point. Verse 19, circumcision is nothing. Yes, I am. It's the cutting away of the foreskin on the male private parts. In the Jewish community, when the baby was 8 days old, that's when they did it to him. You got to understand, many Gentiles were saved that were not under that bondage and under that law and had not been circumcised. So Apostle Paul is dealing with that. Verse 19, circumcision is nothing, and uncircumcision is nothing, but the keeping of the commandments of God, that's what's important, doing what God told you to do. Let every man abide in the same calling in which he is called. The way God saved you, and if he came into your life and you know you're saved, you know you're born again, don't worry about so many little trivial things. Just do what God told you to do. Keep his commandments and walk in love, and God will be pleased with you. Shall we read in verse 21? Art thou called, being a servant, care not for it, but if thou mayest be made free, use it rather. I'm going to tell you something. All of us long to be free. Number one, from punching the time clock. We want to be free and go so we can do a work and a tangible work for the Lord. And you, I don't care who you are, if art thou called being a servant? Question mark. Care not for it. But if thou mayest be made free, use it rather. You got to understand that was a different day where there were servants. People had servants and it was legal back then. In the day that we live, they can't do a whole lot of things they used to do unless they do it in shady ways on the black market and things of that nature. Shall we read verse 22? For he that is called in the Lord, being a servant, is the Lord's free man. Free man, the Lord's free man. Likewise also he that is called, being free, is Christ's servant. We're free. Well, we don't have to go and do and be a servant to another man, but I let you know you still a servant to our Lord. You ought to be a servant to him and give him all you can and do all you can to please him. Shall we read verse 23? Ye are bought with a price. Be not ye the servants of men. Verse 24, brethren, let every man in whatever state he is called, there abide with God. Regardless to who you are, just stay with God. Stay on the Lord's side. If you are a servant, stay with God. If you're a free man, stay with God. If you're free in your spirit, stay with God. The Lord loves you, my friends, and so do I. If you would like to contact me for any reason, you can contact me at the Word with Chester Ministries, Post Office Box 200483, San Antonio, Texas, 78220. You can also reach me at my website, www.poemsbychester.com. Remember, I love you, my friends. I love you with the love of the Lord. God bless you.